Summer 1976. London. Fox continues to increase the budget of the Star Wars, now past the $10 million mark.
It's not enough.
George's stress level continued to rise, and talking to Marsha back in L.A. seemed to help. But now George was breaking bad news, trying to explain why he'd put much of their personal savings into this struggling film.
400 grand? George, that's our money.
We need it for the special effects.
What if we never get that back?
Marsha had a point. Movies flop all the time. But George didn't have time to think it over. He was all in.
Fox won't pay for it.
Like his friend Steven Spielberg on Jaws, George was still rewriting parts of the script as they were shooting scenes.
Skywalker.
Luke Starkiller is now Luke Skywalker, and George has been wrestling with a major plot twist, killing off a major character.
Come in. Alec, thank you for making time. Of course, George.
Sir Alec Guinness was the only established actor in the cast. He's had opinions on Obi-Wan's story arc, and is frustrated at what he sees as George's indecisiveness.
So, what do you think? Well, we think Darth Vader should kill off Obi-Wan and the Death Star.
Alec couldn't believe his ears. The decision should have been made months ago, so the actors could prepare and give the right performances.
Isn't it a bit late for such decisions?
It was actually Marsha who suggested Obi-Wan's death. It would make the revenge of blowing up the Death Star even more satisfying in the end. George saw Alec's temperature rising.
I'm not doing this. Actually, I don't have to do this at all.
Alec, I know it's frustrating.
George, frustrating? Let me explain. So in the last half of the movie, Obi-Wan doesn't really have anything to do while Luke saves the galaxy.
Maybe it was George's patience to explain the new story arc. Maybe it was the $15,000 a week, or maybe the 2% of the entire film's profits Alec had been promised. Who knew if it would amount to much anymore, but something about George gave him reassurance, even as things on set were about to get much worse.
I should have expected to find you holding Vader's leash. I recognized your foul stench when I was brought on board.
Cut. Can we do it again faster? More intense?
George was an idea person, not an especially warm and friendly one to strangers, and this union crew didn't seem to trust him. George always expected them to work until he got the perfect shot. But he was constantly interrupted by hard union-mandated breaks, at least four of them every day.
10 a.m., tea time. 1:15, it's lunch, everyone. 4 p.m., tea time. 5:30, and that's a wrap.
Each break required a reset, and George wasn't getting the shots he needed.
George, I don't know about this line.
That was Harrison Ford. He often found his dialogue clunky, unnatural. He'd improvise where he could, but sometimes his lines were a mouthful that seemed to slow the scene down.
You can type this shit, but you can't say it.
Okay, we'll rewrite. That's a day, everyone.
Pressure was building. Fox had lost faith in George, who kept asking for more money and time for his new scenes. The studio suggested bringing in another director to take over. But George's producer, Gary Kurtz, held them off.
With the hours you're putting in, I think you're getting paid about $1.10 an hour.
Tell me about it. I'm stretched too thin. The movie's too big.
A big film meant fewer things George could do himself. And with hundreds of crew members, everyone needed his input. He knew he'd never finish with a union crew that quit at 5:30 each day, sometimes hours away from the shots he needed.
Gary, I'm gonna ask the union for a vote.
The vote would ask the union to waive their breaks.
Are you sure you'll win? This'll look terrible if it doesn't work.
George knew the vote would be tight, but he just needed a majority. Some of the crew clearly thought the film was ridiculous, but by forcing a vote, if he won, the crew would have to unite behind him, just like Alec Guinness did. He could make up lost time and save his movie. That was Gary calling with the results of the vote.
Hello?
George, we didn't get the votes.
We lost?
It wasn't even close, George.
The crew had united, all right, united against this goofy American kids movie whose director was always asking for more. Now, no one believed in him. George had lost the goodwill and trust of his entire crew. Mobile, Alabama.
Oh my God!
an incredible summer storm, the kind you only get in the American South. Cracks of lightning split the sky. Inside the Air Force hangar, the crew is trying to shoot despite the incredible noise around them. The ground rumbles with each crack, louder and louder. It made it difficult for Steven's crew to hear anything.
Okay, everyone, we're not getting anything done today. We'll pick it up tomorrow.
Then, a boom. A flash of light, the south side of the hangar ripped open. The hangar wall, 100 feet tall, began to buckle, and the rain began to pound Steven's elaborate set and props through the opening.
Everybody, take cover!
Get the cameras out of the way! The hangar's gonna buckle! Come on, everybody, take cover!
Luckily, no one was hurt, but the storm had blown open one end of the hangar, which they'd been using to shoot night scenes during the day, and the rain had damaged parts of the set. It would be expensive. They'd have to put shooting on hold until crews could repair the damage.
Hello?
George, it's Alan.
Summer, 1976, London. Alan Ladd Jr. was the only executive left at Fox that still believed in George.
This union thing is not good for us.
I know.
The stress had finally done George in. His health had turned. He'd developed a fever, a hacking cough, and had hurt to speak. Nearly 4 months into production, it was clear the film wouldn't make its Christmas release date. It would have to move 6 months later, to summer of next year. The board at Fox felt the production was starting to jeopardize their bottom line, and even Alan knew their time was up.
George, you know I wouldn't be calling if it wasn't dire. They're giving us an ultimatum.
What do you mean, an ultimatum?
You have 1 week to finish, or they're gonna shut you down. They'll pay for a second and third unit, but I can't go into the next board meeting and tell them we're still shooting. They're gonna pull the plug.
George had no choice. His friend, Steven Spielberg, had offered to fly in to run the second unit, with the Close Encounter set still under repair. But George was embarrassed, ashamed. He couldn't let Steven know how bad things were, how badly he'd screwed things up. What would Steven think of him? George and Gary would find their second unit elsewhere. For the final week of production, George sprinted from stage to stage between multiple crews filming at the same time.
Hey, this shot needs to be a close-up.
Close-up? The shortlist says a wide.
He tried to prioritize his most important shots before his time ran out. He also decided on a title change. The Star Wars sounded so pretentious, and his movie clearly wasn't going to be what he had planned. Now, it was just Star Wars. With shooting done, he'd turn his attention to editing on a film that had long overstayed its welcome. For weeks, George had been unhappy with the early edits of his movie. The studio had recommended a British editor, John Jimson, who'd assembled footage shot each day on set. George cringed as he watched the edits. Nothing felt right. It was boring. Wide shot after wide shot. It was like looking at a series of still images. Spliced throughout were notes for the effects being created back in L.A. Explosion goes here. Spaceship here. Lasers fire here. This was not the same movie George had envisioned. The characters had no chemistry together. Star Wars had no heart.
This is Marcia.
Hey, babe. Listen, I have a question for you. We need a new edit. From scratch.
It would be Marcia Lucas, who had just finished editing a film with Martin Scorsese, who would come in to re-edit Star Wars. As it turned out, she would be the film's secret weapon over the next few months, sorting through more than 340,000 feet of film to find the passion in each character and storyline. July 18th, 1976, Mobile, Alabama. On his way back from London, George made plans to visit Steven on the set of Close Encounters. They were meeting at a motel that had become Steven's unofficial office.
There he is.
Steve.
Come here, buddy.
the two were happy to see each other, but both surprised at how the other had aged in just a few months' time.
What's that you got?
Steven had been asking to see footage of George's ambitious movie for months.
Oh, here.
Before George left London, he'd made a booklet of glossy photos to share, just filmmaker to filmmaker.
George, this is some of the greatest stuff I've ever seen. Look at that detail on the Millennium Falcon, that's incredible.
Steven saw George's anxiety. He understood completely.
Wow, unbelievable.
The two flipped through the pages together as if kids again, turning the pages of a comic book.
It took us 4 weeks to build that background. You can't even see it.
Ah, Han Solo, look at Harrison.
With each image Steven lavished praise, George mentioned the bad lighting, or how the camera operator had missed the shot.
Well, yeah, it's not really what I thought it'd be.
George was clearly depressed, but Steven wasn't sure why.
George, this looks incredible. It'll be a miracle if Close Encounters looks half this good.
Their two movies were now slated for release within a month of each other, both summer of 1977. Both expensive, big-budget sci-fi adventures. Fox and Columbia saw them as rivals. Steven shared some of his own work with George from inside the Air Force hangar.
We were shooting night scenes in there during the day, but since the side blew off, we can only shoot at night. Most of the crew is nocturnal.
Oh, that's genius.
Oh, check this out. I got a letter from NASA.
NASA?
They think the film is likely to cause a panic. I guess with people seeing UFOs.
They wrote all that?
Yeah, 20 pages of it. It's pretty boring, actually. I was hoping they'd tell me I had the aliens all wrong.
Your movie is gonna make so much money. And John did the theme?
We shot to it. He mailed us a tape so we could play it on set.
Oh, that's incredible.
He's amazing, George. Just wait till you hear what he comes up with for Star Wars.
Both George and Steven had more faith in each other than in themselves.
Here. I'll tell you what, George. I'll trade points with you. 2.5%.
So I'll give you 2.5% of Star Wars for 2.5% of Close Encounters?
Yep. I'll gamble with that.
Okay, let's do it.
They seal it with a handshake that neither of them had any idea would be worth over $40 million.
Well, we'll see what happens then.
Fall 1976, Hollywood. John Williams has been writing themes for Star Wars for some time, enjoying the rich tapestry of characters and worlds all blending into one story.
Yeah, that's it.
Johnny!
George! So good to see you.
With George is Lionel Newman, the head of music for Fox.
Lionel, my friend.
Johnny!
George, what a marvelous adventure you've created.
George looked depressed. He hadn't seen John since Star Wars was still just a concept. Now he could see all its flaws.
I heard you visited Steven in Mobile.
I did. You should see the production he's running.
He's had me working on a few things you can see over there in that stack. It's interesting, all based on 5 notes.
Oh.
But if I may direct your attention to the big table over here, this is your music for Star Wars.
Against the wall was a long wooden table and a neat spread of loose paper, sheet music, sketchbooks, and brightly colored dividers.
That's all for me.
It was organized so they could quickly jump in to any scene in the film.
I think you might like Luke Starkiller's theme in particular. Excuse me, Skywalker now, right?
Yeah, Luke Skywalker.
I like that a lot better too. Where shall we begin?
Well, let's start at the beginning.
Very good. Lionel, dear, would you flip the switch for me?
Of course.
John and George walk over to the piano.
So right as the first frame comes in, what's wrong?
John, it's beautiful.
Oh, you had me concerned.
No, it's the most beautiful thing I've ever heard.
It really is, Johnny.
So here's the B theme. concludes with this. Even louder.
George could barely believe it. For 2 hours, they made their way through the film, John playing his music at the piano. Even the placeholders for special effects shots seemed, somehow, to all work with John's music.
Johnny, this is all incredible, really.
So glad to hear that, George.
The last thing, I had a question for you, John. If we can pull up the cantina scene?
George had been approved to do some reshoots. One of those was the cantina scene. It was the scene where Luke first meets Han Solo.
Sort of the beginning of their adventure together.
Are you thinking original score here, or more source music?
No, not a score. Mm. Well, so there's a band playing in the cantina. I was thinking we should be hearing some kind of a bizarre, Western country, primitive rock music.
Something maybe jazzy. It's a cantina band. Maybe a Benny Goodman quality to it?
Yes, I like that. But like a people 1,000 years in the future found it. Under a rock. You know, and they're trying to interpret it, and it sounds a little strange.
That description itself was strange.
Hmm.
Lionel smiled knowingly, eager to hear what John would improvise.
A bit off balance.
Yeah.
John turned back to the piano and began to rock his shoulders side to side as if dancing to terrible, upbeat jazz music. Then he began to play.
That's it.
That's it?
It's perfect.
John, you're a master.
George had lost track of time. He was due at the special effects warehouse in Van Nuys to review the shots created while he was away filming.
John, fantastic work. I'm looking forward to the recording session in London.
The London Symphony Orchestra, in fact. They can't wait to record.
Van Nuys, California. It's the warehouse of Industrial Light and Magic, the company George had started to create cutting-edge special effects for his movie.
Hey, Mr. Lucas.
Hey, is John Dykstra in here?
John Dykstra ran the day-to-day. All around him, George could see bits and pieces of miniature sets, lights, camera rigs, the Death Star, and part of his Millennium Falcon. John was getting George up to speed on their progress.
Well, we're behind. We're building our own electronics here, not just the miniatures. The camera moves have to be smooth and the lighting has to match.
How far behind? I thought you were doing that months ago.
We were, but you know, it's a lot, George. We have 360 shots in the script. And we're gonna need more time or more help to get it done.
How far along are we?
Not very far.
Halfway? A third of the way?
It's complicated.
John, we have 360 shots. How many are done?
Three.
Three?
And they look great. They do.
Oh, my God.
George felt something. Was it rage? He tried to fight it back. The news nearly knocked the wind out of him. He took deep breaths. In months, ILM had completed just 3 of the 360 shots they needed. They weren't even 1% of the way there. It was a nightmare, worse than a nightmare. For the first time, the panic fully set in. Without these shots, his movie could never be finished. George tried to regain his composure in his car when he felt a jump in his chest. Then again, his heart was pounding. He was sure this was a heart attack. He only had a few minutes to get to the hospital. He tried to slow his heart rate by breathing slowly, but it wasn't working. The hospital wasn't far, and he knew he had to try. His car ripped around the corner and into the emergency room roundabout, leaving his car door open and rushing in through the sliding double doors.
I think I'm having a heart attack. I need help.
Sir, are you all right?
Sir, are you having chest pain?
All right, sir, can you hear me? I'm delighted.
Doctors had rushed George to a bed. Marcia had now joined him at the hospital. Mr. Lucas?
Yes.
Yeah?
Well, the good news is you didn't have a heart attack. I reviewed your vitals and medical history, and I think this may have been anxiety-related. Have you been under a lot of stress?
That's one way to put it.
Mm-hmm. What I think this is extreme stress exacerbating hypertension, sometimes referred to as exhaustion. It does require immediate attention, so it's good that you came in.
So what does that mean?
It means you're at risk of it happening again. So I highly recommend that you make efforts to reduce that immediately. It can potentially trigger a heart attack.
George stared straight ahead as he listened. Marcia held his hand. Reduce his stress level? If he left for even a day, the whole thing would fall apart.
I'm directing a movie for Fox. I don't know if I can possibly reduce my stress level.
Well, Mr. Lucas, I recommend you find a way.
Depression sunk in as the doctor walked away. Just hours after arguing over special effects, George sat in a hospital gown, contemplating his life. A sobering reminder that even dreams have their limits. George would have to choose between Star Wars and his life. He and Marcia looked at each other. They both knew the decision was already made.